Upsize Minnesota and Club Entrepreneur offer you today's panel. As such, I want to introduce you to our event sponsors, the accounting firm Barton, Walter & Creer, the M&A advisory firm Franklin Partners, general practice law firm Gray Plant Moody, and a banking and financial services firm, The Private Bank. So thank you very much to our sponsors and supporters. And with that, I'm going to introduce now our panelists. Tom Barton is a shareholder and leader of the M&A practice at Barton, Walter & Creer. Chris Carlisle is an attorney and partner, co-chair and the general business and tax group, Gray Plant Moody. John Falb is managing director and the Upper Midwest region head for The Private Bank. Dean Jones, from the entrepreneurial side of the world, is the CEO of Project or Power Objects, which was sold to HCL Technologies last year. And then lastly, Chip Myers is founder of Franklin Partners. As we turn to those folks, why don't we start here with you, Tom. Tell us a little bit about your background, bio, a little bit about your firm, and how you fit into today's panel.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, first of all. My name's Tom Barton. I'm a founding partner with the CPA firm of Barton, Walter & Creer. We're a boutique firm of 30 professionals in Maple Grove that we pretty much deal only with successful, closely held businesses. We pride ourselves on being different, I think, than a lot of CPA firms. We've come up with some really great tax-saving strategies. We've implemented recently some great cash balance plans, and probably what I'm going to talk about a little today is captive insurance companies, specifically 831B microcaps. It's basically a tax arbitrage and deferral strategy. With the recent law changes, you can now defer up to $2.4 million, and we're presently working with a client selling their business utilizing a captive to defer a lot of the sales proceeds from the sale.
Great, thank you very much. Chris?
So I am one of the co-chairs of our general corporate finance group and one of the co-chairs of our emerging companies group. And so what I do is help entrepreneurs, what I used to call cradle to grave in terms of the finance strategy of the firm, from helping them get started, getting early stage seed funding if that's required, through sale of the business. A lot of what I do, probably over half of my practice, is focused on helping entrepreneurs through M&A processes, whether that be an outright sale of their business, whether it be a joint venture type strategy, or whether they are acquiring other companies to build a bigger mousetrap. I'm really glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
Great. Thank you, Chris. John?
Thanks, Rick. So I work for The Private Bank, as Rick mentioned, which is a publicly traded and owned bank headquartered in Chicago. I oversee the Upper Midwest region, which encompasses four offices, one each in Minneapolis, Denver, Des Moines, and Milwaukee. And we are a very focused business model in the middle market commercial banking business. So smaller businesses, often family owned. We work closely with families and the owners of businesses to help them through M&A transactions and all kinds of other strategic initiatives, whether it's building new plants or father or son buying out father, all those kinds of strategic things that the families or owners of these small businesses need to get done. I've been here in the Twin Cities since 2006, so for about 10 years. It's a great market for us. Prior to The Private Bank, which started in 2008 up here, I was with LaSalle Bank, doing the same thing, so just a different name now. I also am happy to have with me today the Minneapolis office. Just want to point them out real quick. Doug Pudva over here, Leanne Manning, Adam Oliver, Tom Christner, which I think is arguably the most experienced and probably deepest commercial banking team here in the Twin Cities. So if you have questions, issues about commercial banking, you've got a great team here in addition to me that would be happy to talk to you about those kinds of things. Thanks.
Great, thanks, John. And Dean, tell us a little bit about you.
Sure, so a quick background on me. I actually study business and I love technology. So when I got out of college, I decided to learn technology. I worked for Anderson Consulting for 3 years and said, this is great, I'm gonna start my own business. So I have taken a business from employee number one, which was myself, to 300 employees. I've taken it from zero revenue to 41 million in revenue. We had a lot of fun doing it. I now also had the opportunity to go through a sale of a company, and I would be happy to share some of the things that has happened through the journey of growing a company and selling a company. Thank you.
And then prior to the event, talked a little bit to Dean about how valuable that perspective is to this conversation. So thanks for participating, Dean. And then Chip has been on some of our panels in the past, appreciate you coming back and supporting us again. Tell us a little bit about Franklin Partners.
Thanks, Rick. Franklin Partners is a specialized M&A boutique specializing in lower middle market companies. In our world, that means companies that have enterprise values under $100 million. We are five seasoned business people who have spent most of their careers helping companies grow either in transactions or capital raising sort of functions. Our business is purely mergers and acquisitions, principally sell side. I have a couple of my wonderful partners here with me today. Joe Caruso is sitting right in front of me. And Joel Fisher. Joel, where are you? Over here. We have a lot of fun. We work on a small number of transactions a year. People like Dean, we like to, and there are a couple of our other clients here. We like to say that we start out with business relationships and we make friends. The M&A process is a long and complex road. It has a lot of ups and downs. We have a lot of fun doing it and we make a lot of wonderful friends today. And I'm happy to participate in this with you today.
And then I have to say again, you pointed out his partner Joe Caruso in the front row. Joe and I used to work together back in the late 80s and we went to the same kind of onboarding meeting, and so I don't know that I've known anybody longer in my business career than Joe Caruso. So anyway, nice to see you, Joe. All right, so as far as the panel today and kind of how we organize this, our intent is to make this about you, not about us per se. So at any point in time, if somebody has a question, please raise your hand and I'll do my best to kind of make that happen. I have a list of some questions that I'll start on and kind of go through, but again, if anybody has any questions along the way, please raise your hand and we'll try to get to you. All right, for everybody on the panel, no particular order on an answer, but first question is, in anticipation of selling a business, what advanced planning should a seller consider? And then there are kind of two parts to that is, first on a personal level, and then secondly, from the business perspective.
So from the legal perspective, I think there's a lot that can be done in pre-planning. And most of that revolves around assembling the due diligence, assembling the homework that a prospective buyer is going to want to look at in anticipation of your business. And some of that is going to be intuitively obvious to you, the financials, where's the business going, market strategy, et cetera. Some of it is going to be very granular, detail type stuff like employee benefits and tax stuff that isn't going to be as intuitive to you. And thinking about those things in advance and getting your arms around those things in advance can make the process go a lot more smoothly.
And make sure you pick a very good advisor to do that, i.e. one of us up here would be good.
I guess I'd add to that, I think it's important to start with some kind of end in mind. Most of the companies, business owners, and we work primarily with entrepreneurs, come to us because they've been approached by someone and they've tried to put a transaction together and it hasn't been successful and they feel this need to go forward with this. And one of the first things that we do is talk about what their objectives are. And it's for most of our clients, this is maybe the most complex and important thing that they'll do in their business career. And to start that without an end in mind is a difficult thing to do because you are going to end up somewhere. And if it isn't where you want it to be, it's going to be hard to pull the trigger. And it frequently starts by somebody else initiating it. And so I think it's worthwhile to have thought that through in anticipation of it.
I think in my line of work, it's really important to have a great network. So if I have a client call me with that question, it's real easy. Let's have lunch with Chip.
Well, to give a plug to Franklin, when I have clients coming to me asking these questions, and he's right, oftentimes it becomes a natural acquirer, whether it be a customer or a supplier or something, has made an overture or you've gotten a call out of the blue, getting people thinking about it. I think one of the things that you really want to be thinking hard about is how do you create a market for your business? It's not oftentimes how entrepreneurs think about it, but how do we get the best value? And more often than not, it is not with going with the natural acquirer that has given you a cold call or said, hey, maybe we should talk about selling the business. A lot more thought needs to be put into it if you want to get maximum value for the business, and talking to folks like Franklin is a way to do that.
Yeah, so I would add to that you should be controlling the conversation. My phone would ring every month. Hey, you interested in selling? I could have wasted an enormous amount of time if I entertained these calls. So what we would do is we actually said, here's our game plan. We knew when we wanted to sell, and we took it to, you know, to Franklin and said, here's what we want to do. We did not entertain any of these offers over the last, you know, 2-3 years. So you want to control it. We took it to market instead of just listening to the market say, hey, you want to sell, you want to sell, you want to sell. It would be a waste of time. So,
Dean, just to jump on that and take that a little further, when did you think it was the right time to sell?
So, I think that's going to be personal for everyone, but in my case, I had a certain number I wanted. If I had this much money, I'd be happy. You could say, well, why not keep growing it? Why not keep having fun? So I had a certain size I wanted to take the company to, and a business changes. You know, 50 employees is different than 100, is different than 300. So there's a time when the company will be changing. So in my case, I knew what I wanted for the company. My goal was to continue to grow it. And I don't want to time the market perfectly. I didn't want to wait and say, yeah, maybe we could grow it another 50% next year. I mean, we grew every year over 40%. So did I want to say, yeah, we could do it again next year? At some point, you have to say, I'm at my number, I'm where I wanted to be, and then you engage your banker, your lawyer, and start to work to take the product to market.
Okay. So. For the rest of the panel, it's that same question from your perspective. You folks, when do you think the right time to sell is?
Well, I think Dean said it well. I mean, it really depends on the entrepreneur and the situation. I mean, for family businesses, sometimes it can be a family transition and there's a natural inflection point. Sometimes it can be market driven. Folks see things in the market that they say, okay, I wanna make sure I'm pivoting before that happens. Some folks are very attuned to kind of where their number is, what Dean said. I think, again, the pre-planning, I think, is a key part of the whole process.
And I think you hit on a key there, Chris. Different companies, different industries, different macroeconomic factors at play. There were companies that didn't sell that were thinking about it pre-cycle back in 06, 07 that wished they had. And then when things got better, they did. But some of them wished they would have the first time around. So it's kind of reading the economy, reading the factors within your industry, and making that good call. And again, working with an advisor who sees a lot more companies like yours can be a key part of making that decision. So,
I think a case study that our firm worked with would really be a good example here. We had an entrepreneur that grew his company from 0 to $15 million in revenue, made about $2 million a year, and was very frustrated. At first, I really couldn't understand why you'd be frustrated making $2 million every year not working too hard. But his company was best in class, and he knew that he was in a $100 million market, and he knew that he did not have the skill set to get to that level. So really selling for him and staying on as a participant with equity going forward was really a growth strategy instead of a exit strategy.
Chip, you want to add anything on that one?
I don't really think so, except that I think that people call us all the time and say, well, what are market multiples now, and is this a good time to sell? And in kind of summary what others have said, I would say I don't know. There's a strong, enduring market for lower middle market companies. People like Keith and Paul sitting here in front of us have funds ready to buy. all the time, regardless of the cycles in the market. That's different than it was a generation ago. So I think it has more to do with your business, the opportunity for it going forward, and your willingness to continue to do that or to gain some liquidity. And I think it takes a generation ago, maybe people, like they went to work for companies and worked their whole careers, they started companies and worked the company the whole career, and that's changed. And when I started this 25 years ago, something awful like that, I thought I'd be selling old guys manufacturing companies, and I'm not. I'm working with younger people who have an idea, can take it to a certain place, and seem to have a very good sense of where they can take it. And I think one of the biggest mistakes that people make is they don't realize when they're there, and they hang on too long. And so I think it really comes down to knowing yourself, knowing what you have, knowing your industry and your competition, and knowing when's a good time. And it takes a lot of discipline to pull the trigger when it happens, but that's how I feel.
At least in the lower middle market, A-plus assets are always highly prized. I mean, we were doing transactions with some clients in 2007, 2008, 2009, when the markets were quote unquote down, and if you've got a good business, there's plenty of people out there that wanna buy it.
Yeah, so somebody once told me that a good time to sell your business is when you have a buyer. A better time to sell your business is when you have two buyers. So, I mean, you gotta put it out there.
I wish I would have said that.
So everybody has a unique perspective up here on the panel. From that perspective, talk a little bit about the sales process, what it means to you and the various verticals you're in, and then why assemble outside advisors to help you with that.
No.
Well, I'll start with it. The first part of it is what's the process, and I'm presuming that most of this audience is private companies. So if you think about the stock market, there's rules and there's information that's shared, and there's an ability for investors to evaluate things, and there are comparables, and there's analysts writing reports, and so there's a free exchange of information, and there's at least some expectation of what things are worth. There isn't in the private world. There's no information. Nobody knows about your business. And I would also say it's better that until you're ready to sell, nobody should know too much about your business. And so the process is really about, if you choose to do it this way, is about establishing a market for your company in a very discreet way so that you can obtain what my partner Joe refers to as a market clearing price, a price that should reflect what a mix of buyers with the same information would pay for a business like this. And one never knows what a business is worth to someone. And can I say that when we marketed Dean's company, there were a broad range of it was a very well understood product and market opportunity, but there was still a broad range of values because it was worth more to other people, and we couldn't possibly know that. So the process is about sharing that information with enough people that you can tease that value out. Now, I don't want to stay on too long, but this thing about advisors, the way I look at it is, if you're selling in today's environment, the guys on the other team, you have to presume have the A team all the way along. You know, from the guys making the deals to the attorneys negotiating the purchase agreement to the people doing the diligence. People like the gentleman I mentioned hire professional firms to do the financial diligence, professional people to do the market diligence. So, I mean, do you want to go in there with, one bullet in your pistol, or do you want to go in there with an A-team yourself? And the first deal I worked on, was a little company in Owatonna, and the attorney was a very nice guy from Owatonna, but he was clueless about how to do a transaction. And I was working by myself, and I really didn't have anybody to confide in. My father was kind of a successful guy in this. I called him up, and I said, you know, it never occurred to me. All my life I'd worked with good attorneys. And it had just never occurred to me that there were bad attorneys out there because I'd never seen one. And so, you know, we got jammed a little bit at the end because we had somebody who couldn't see it coming. And so, when Joe and I started this, we said, we're not going to work with somebody if they're not well represented, because we can't afford to be on a team that's a B team or a C team.
For me, it's a lot of it is I build relationships with clients over a long period of time. I mean, I knew Dean and Jim's partner for the better part of 9 years and really got to know them and got to know their personalities, got to know their business a little bit. And when it comes time to kind of bring the company to market, you know, hopefully what I can do in that universe is be a little bit of a guide for the journey, help them select the right advisors, the investment bankers, and so on. It goes both ways, Chip. I mean, I think when I look at successful outcomes for my clients, they have to be advised by the right firm. If they're not, if they're trying to negotiate it on their own, they're going to be leaving money on the table. That's what I see in the marketplace. And so the hope is that you can help your clients get to the right outcome that they're looking for them and their families.
Yeah, with our company, I think we could have done it either way. We actually selected the legal firm first, and then we used the legal firm to help us select our bankers. Now, what you go through is a process of you're really looking for that match, that ongoing, you know, who do you connect with? Because as Chip says, you're assuming you're dealing with A players, so it's really who do you connect with? Who can help you through this ordeal? And I'm not going to say it's easy. Oh, wow, it is great. It was such a fun. We went through this for a year, and we had a blast. It's like it is a stressful time selling your company. And so you want to make sure you're working with people that you're comfortable with, you trust, and you can have those open relationships. So I love the approach we went with. I love the outcome. I love the team we worked with. So it is very important that you work with people you trust. I do believe you can work with your banker and then select a lawyer. I think you could select a lawyer and work with your banker. It's who you have the best relationship with. Now, going forward, we still have a relationship with Chris. We still have a relationship with Chip. We still have a relationship with the accounting firm. We have these relationships ongoing. So.
One other just point: no matter who you're hiring, make sure you're hiring somebody where you are going to be an important client to them. So there's lots and lots of good law firms out there, but whether an entrepreneurial business that's being sold is a key client to that lawyer is a question, right? And there are a lot of good lawyers out there that do all sorts of different things on the corporate finance side. Make sure that it's somebody, investment banking, same thing, accounting, same thing. Folks that want to walk through walls with you, folks that are going to take that call at 12 when, you know, they turned a draft and we need to turn it immediately, that kind of thing. And if you're not a core client to that person, that service provider, it's gonna impact the deal and it's gonna impact the advice you get.
Tom, anything from the accounting perspective?
Well, I think we probably work more on the front end, making the proper introductions, and then on the back end, working in conjunction with somebody like Chip, making sure the deal is structured right for the best tax outcome possible.
I guess one just a little different perspective. As a commercial bank, a sell-side process is usually bad news for us because we're probably going to get our credit paid off and our relationship specifically in terms of products and services and advice with the family and so forth can change and sometimes go away. So it's not always a great thing for us. But a piece of advice I would throw out there on the sell-side process is make sure you have your financial house in order. I can think of several situations in the last couple of years where a firm went to market to be sold, and it turned out that their financial information wasn't in good shape. Some things had been missed. There had been some turnover in the CFO controller area, and the financial house was not in order. And as due diligence played out, those things were found. It delayed the process. It impacted valuation. It created the need for significantly more due diligence. It can really have a big effect on your sale process. So having that financial and accounting house in order is very important. So.
Great, thanks, John. David?
So the question really was, did we know HCL? Did we bring HCL to the table? And the answer is no, we did not. So when we started the process, we all listed all sorts of companies that we would expect to buy us. Here's the people that should be interested in us. And we went after 100 different organizations. So HCL, I don't even think they were in the first round that we went after. So they were a fantastic organization, so we liked the way they dealt with us. Slower than I would have liked. Their organization made decisions slower. You know, we were a 300 person shop. We pause the music, we make a decision, we move forward. They have 14 lawyers look at it, and the lawyer questions the lawyer, and so it was a very long, tedious process. But they were not who I expected to buy us in the beginning. There's two other companies that I thought were gonna be the ones that were gonna acquire us. And am I happy with the outcome? Super happy. It's a great deal. It's a great organization. We're excited to keep growing the company.
That's a follow-up question.
Yep.
Based on what you just said, you went through 100 people and didn't get a buyer. They were in the second group, and they were slow.
They were not in the second group. I just don't know if they were on the first initial list of people we were sending out our initial letter of who we are and what offers out there. You know, here's a company. Didn't anyone in our industry, if they read that letter, they probably knew it was Power Objects. But this letter went out maybe to 60 different organizations. We had some other meetings and we identified some additional organizations, and that letter went out to multiple people. No, I probably can't go into all of it in great detail, but we walked from the deal. We said, screw you, we'll grow the company for another 5 years. We're making money, we're growing, we're having a great time. So we walked from the deal at one point and then came back to the table. Some people talked us off the ledge. It was a good thing. Well, I mean, it was a good deal. It was a good thing. I'm super happy. The team took us through it. We got through it. There's nothing easy about it. If you think I'm gonna sell my company, this is gonna be the most exciting time of my life, you're wrong. It's a long ordeal. There's a lot of stress. So did my number change? Maybe a little bit on the upside. Why? We're growing 40%, we're making a bunch of money. So they're gonna try to point out dents and scratches on the car before they buy it. And you're either gonna like think bad of your company, or you're gonna be like, no, that's not a dent, here's why. You know. So we were very passionate about what we were doing, and so I wasn't going to listen to someone tell us we weren't running a good company. And we've done a lot of the things the organization here said. We were prepared financially. We structured the company the way we thought. We cleaned up the books. We paid for audits for the last prior 2 years. The numbers were really, really tight. So we were pretty confident in what we could do going forward. The process took so long. You know, we're kind of selling the company on the 2015 numbers. Well, 2015, we hit our numbers, and you know, so now we didn't close until October. So it was a long ordeal, and a lot happens over a 12-month period in a fast-growing company. So,
question here in front.
Yeah, this is always a call to some of the comments you just made. So knowing there's so many aspects that have to go into selling.
Yeah, I think as a benchmark, I always tell clients, you know, it's a 6 month to a year process. I mean, if you're going to do it right, if you're going to start from, you know, as Dean was sort of alluding to, the, you know, we're going to create a list, we're going to sort of winnow it. And Chip can talk more about that, but I think it's a 6 month to a year process, and a little bit of that depends on, you know, how prepared are they for the market, right? So Someone mentioned, you know, have a good finance person. I mean, how are the finances? Are they in order? Are we able to, you know, having a key CFO or controller or somebody that's going to help on that score, you know, position the firm for market is a key driver in terms of the timing.
Chime in on that one? No, hold on, I got one over here.
What advice do you have for the senior leadership of the people on the buy side? You know, people who are out trying to do the acquisitions.
I think there's two types. There's the financial buyers, the private equity firms and so forth, and they, for the most part, have a very consistent and streamlined process around how they do deals. They have outside advisors, as was mentioned earlier, that help them with diligence. They have deal counsel that they're accustomed to working with. They're accustomed to the transition and the disruption within the business itself. Those processes, in my experience, tend to go a little faster because the buyers sort of understand the process. I think, depending on the nature of the enterprise, the strategic buyers tend to be a little bit slower. They tend to have a slower decision-making process. The biz dev group oftentimes will bring a deal to the table, but the operational leaders within the organization are the ones that drive it, and they're not necessarily accustomed to the M&A process. And so that can drag the process out. It can make the lawyering side of things, in particular, a lot more painful because they're going to, as somebody said, the one lawyer looks to the other lawyer and you know, needs to have that triple checked, and that's not how entrepreneurial organizations tend to work. So
I was going to say, having bought companies in a prior life, I think buying companies is a lot harder than selling companies because you have to well, you start from a certain perspective of what you're after. My experience is that most people haven't got that entirely thought through, and then you've got to gauge the risk of what you're evaluating, and it's really easy to get enamored with a person or a product or a market opportunity and sort of overlook the risks and other issues involved. And then I think, and I, having done this myself, if you engage with somebody that maybe you initiate and they weren't ready to sell and they don't have an advisor, God, that can go on forever because they have no expectations and they're not prepared for it. I would say the single biggest thing I've learned doing this after all these years is that people underestimate how rigorous the process is. And management, you heard what Dean said, how much work it is, and you know, I mean, I feel this way, but we do most of the work. And
I do feel that way.
You know, we carry most of the water, and we try to ride the roller coaster for our clients, the emotional roller coaster, so that somebody can keep some perspective on what's going on here. But on a buy, you know, if you're a buyer and you're going out to, you know, you call on somebody and say, do you want to sell your company, and you engage with this guy, and he doesn't know what he really wants to do, and he's not prepared, and he has no appreciation for this, I think that's really difficult. So after having done both, I really think it's harder to be a buyer than a seller.
Okay. While we're on the buy side, and then we'll get your question next, John. Tom, from an accounting perspective, and John, from a banking perspective, how does the buy side look different in your world?
Well, in the accounting world, we sure like the buy side because we're gaining a client. So that's more attractive. I think a lot of our clients have grown very well through acquisitions. Sometimes one key acquisition has really been the catalyst that's catapulted them forward. Probably for us, the buy side is harder too, because just I think someone said, you don't know what you don't know, and we're in and we're trying to understand the business and is this going to be a good fit and the due diligence. So that's certainly more difficult, but it's a little more rewarding than saying goodbye.
And I agree. We go from being unhappy, as I mentioned, on the sell side oftentimes too excited about a client that's going to be involved in a buy-side transaction. That's where we get to roll up our sleeves and sit down and work closely with a family or an ownership group about why does it make sense strategically to buy this company? How does it fit into your existing business? How does it look going forward? What kind of capital structure makes sense for the business on a combined basis? How much debt, how much junior capital should be on this balance sheet? What does this cash flow really look like? Let's stress your cash flow. Let's go back to the last cycle in 2006, 7, 8, 9 and look at what happened to the company's financial performance then, yours and the targets. And let's look at that scenario and see what would happen if something similar happens again. And make sure we don't get too levered. Some companies are very cyclical and shouldn't have as much leverage. Some companies can handle more leverage. And then a lot of discussion and focus around what kind of due diligence do we need to get that done. Market studies, quality of earnings, kinds of due diligence, and all kinds of other things are things we'll need as a bank, and they probably should be thinking about as well. So that the buy-side process is actually something we always look forward to and are very involved in with our companies and our owners. So,
sell-side can be bittersweet for a lawyer. You're losing a client, but there's something pretty awesome about being at the end game of, you know, oftentimes the entrepreneur's seminal career event. So it's a lot of fun.
Hold on over a second. John Alexander?
Yeah, Chip, as a follow-up to your previous point, and for Dean and anybody else who's been on the sell side, advice you can give somebody who's selling a business and acknowledging how long and cumbersome and involved the process can take so that they can manage their business, hit their numbers, keep their management team together while they're going through this, but still comply with all the requests from the buy side and, of course, the advisory firms.
Well, the way we approach it is we try to take about 4 weeks up front to gather all that information and set up a electronic data room that becomes the basis for the due diligence maybe a better way to put it is we try to have a concentrated effort initially with our client so that we can then manage the process for another 3 or 4 months so that they are able to run the business. And but that's hard. But you know, when you've done this for a long time, you know what's going to be asked, and it's kind of pretty much the same stuff. And you know, we have clients who are very good at that and pull it together. And we, you know, practically have a data room when we go to market. And we have clients whose attitude is, well, see what the offers are, and then I'll do it. And they're the guys who end up burning the candle at both ends, and you know, having to get more people involved. And doing it in a compressed period, and et cetera, et cetera. Does that answer your question?
Maybe I'll answer it a little differently. I mean, buyers can take all the time they want. Sellers work in real time. So, I mean, you really have to, if you get requests, you need to, in my mind, you need to be thinking about it in terms of how can we turn that request within 24 hours or less. And so, to me, to answer your question, part of it is the delegation of duties, right? Who's going to be the quarterback? Who's going to help with diligence? Who's going to do this, that? But then the other element of it is, as Chip said, burning the candle at both ends. There's going to be a little bit of that in every deal, and owners need to be making critical decisions in real time sometimes, and that's just kind of part of the game, and they need to do that in their free time while they're running the business and perform. And the business needs to keep performing while you're doing that.
I just think that the biggest thing is that you got to focus on your business all the time. So you're in the process of selling. It'd be very easy to focus on the sale. It'd be very easy to say, wow, you know, I'm going to strike it rich. Whatever the conversation is, you may be excited and take your eye off the ball. We made a conscious decision constantly to focus on the ball and grow the company. And I don't want to say selling the company was the second effort, but we never once stopped and said, yeah, we got it where we want, let's go sell it. We always kept growing it, so.
I had Jim over here and then over there.
So this is for Chris and Chip. Talk a little bit about how you counsel partners with competing or disparate interests or family members who don't agree.
That's a great one. I think there's sort of there's a lot of layers to that question. I think one at the high end of it is, well, what if you have partners or family members that have a different opinion on whether you should sell or not? And the answer to that question, I think, is, well, get on the same page before you start any sort of process, because it's a recipe for disaster, or it can be a recipe for disaster. I think the managing of expectations in terms of what the value of the business is, that can also be an issue with different partners. And I think a lot of that is just communication and making sure people are making a careful decision and that they're on the same page before they go to market.
Yeah, there's probably two aspects of that. One is how we manage that before we take the engagement, and that's maybe beyond the scope of this conversation. But you know, we have walked away from things because we didn't think we could get everybody on the same page. But it's not infrequent. There are always a couple of things that happen, and I think each of us, and I have four partners, and we all have a little bit different style. Each of us handles this differently. We try very hard to get close to at least the main person. But frequently, you know, we're in a situation where there's a employee who's a key employee, maybe a president or a COO, and this happens to me every year. It happens to you frequently. Who says, well, somewhere in the 11th hour, well, they, I can think about 10 of them running through my head right now. Well, they'll never get this deal done if I don't go along with it. Don't you think I should get something for it? You know, that sort of conversation. And I'm always curious about why they would talk to me about that, because who do they think I'm working for? And I don't know, maybe Joe, you'd answer it differently, but I have generally found that I'm just real straightforward with the person about that. And I have been known, I just want to look around the room here for a minute, to walk a guy out into my office and say, look, this is the way this works. And, you know, I've explained to people, you know, the golden rule, he who has the gold rules, you know, what he stands to get from this. There was one where it was owned by a private equity firm where we're selling it to another private equity firm. The CEO said, well, why should, we're working on the management presentation. He said, well, why should I try hard for this? And I said, to explain to him what could be in this firm. And the company's been sold since then. The guy's made a few million bucks. So, I mean, I was right. But you know, everyone's different, and you just sort of, I personally have found the best way to do it is to just be real direct with the person. But frankly, it's challenging.
We have had a number of clients who diffuse that issue right up front by carving out a section of proceeds from the deal.
But I think my favorite one was the guy wasn't sure he wanted to do the deal, and he called us on a Thursday or Friday, like the week before it was going to close, and called the thing off. You remember this? We were in my car, and so what are we going to do? And it was a really good deal for this business. And I said, let's just wait till Monday, because when he goes home and tells his wife tonight that he's not going to get a check for $25 million next Friday, everything will be okay. And we had one of the ways that we managed it, what you were asking about, is we try to have a weekly call if we can, so it's sort of compartmentalized. And when we had that weekly call on Monday morning, it never came up.
Okay, I got a bunch of things. Hold on for that, just for a moment. Somebody brought up the term valuation. Want to make sure that we touch on that a little bit. Why don't we start with the banker and the accountant on valuation? How are companies valued? What role do you play? And then we'll get to the other guys.
Well, I think what we see is the less ad backs, the bigger the price. When we look at...
Okay, slow down. I think there'd be a lot of people here that maybe that's an important thing. So say that one more time.
I think the less the ad backs, the bigger the price. Maybe that sounds a little counterintuitive, but when we see a financial statement and the owner says, well, we got to add my country club dues back, this expense, $150,000 of travel, et cetera, it just isn't clean. It might seem like a good idea at the time, but it really seems to affect the valuation as opposed to really clean books and doing it the right way and the large valuations that we see.
John?
And I would agree. I think most of the transactional work that we see is all based on cash flow. It's all multiple of some form of cash flow, EBITDA, and very true, Tim, that less ad backs just makes it easier. But at the same time, let's have a credible number. Let's have a number that does make sense, is very defensible, and represents the firm's history on a cash flow basis, and also have, you know, it's hockey season here in Minnesota, but let's not have a hockey stick in terms of your projections that all of a sudden, after years and years of this, we're gonna do this. That never goes well, that kind of waters down the process, doesn't make a lot of sense. So I'd just say be thoughtful, be credible, and have good defensible numbers that will be used for that valuation and that multiple.
Well, I guess I'd say there's sort of two fundamental things here. There's a financial valuation, which you could think of as it's an asset and it provides a certain return, and the market requires a certain return, or your investors require a certain returns, and there's a mathematical equation, and you can take into account certain levels of risk, and you can get to what that's worth. The easiest example of that I can think of is that when I was a young man, I tried to buy that tunnel that runs between Detroit and Canada. I forget what it's called. The Windsor Tunnel came up for sale, and I really thought I had it, you know, nailed. And I mean, you think about it, it's an annuity, you know? And I think that you didn't have to maintain it. I think that you got a stipend from somebody to do it. And, but an insurance company outbid us, and they bought it because, you know, their cost of funds were lower, and so they could put a higher valuation on that annuity stream. So that's one side. The other side might be a company I looked at recently that makes a very innovative, high margin, proprietary product. And the financial valuation, annuity valuation might be here, but in the hands of somebody who has a distribution to quadruple the sales in 2 years, the valuation's here. So that gets back to, it's in the eyes of the buyer. So when people say to me, well, what kind of multiples are companies selling for? I say all over the place, you know, it's depends on what it is. The wonderful thing about lower middle market companies is they're always pretty unique. You know, they're entrepreneurs who have started them. They're guys who, you know, for one reason or another couldn't work like us, couldn't work for a big corporation, had to figure out some way to make a living, found some little crack in the sidewalk, figured out how to do it better than anyone else. And how do you value that? You know, it's unique. Every one of them's unique. And so it's a challenge.
I think it's kind of an interesting question because we did not put a value on our company. The buyers did. So we looked at what the different buyers were willing to pay and we said, we'll take that buyer. So, and it's not necessarily the one with the most money. We had certain things that we wanted, i.e. we wanted to be power objects after the deal. That was kind of a big deal for us. And two of the buyers were willing to say power objects and HCL company, and the other one was going to leave us power objects also. So you might have an idea what you think it's worth. Doesn't mean the market's going to give it, and they might give you more.
Chris, anything on valuation?
One sort of comment on ad backs. I mean, you can't have it both ways on ad backs. I had a client about a year ago. We sold, and one of the positions they took is that, you know, they didn't need the founders. They didn't need a couple of these founders to run the business. And then later on in the process, and then we added back their salaries, which were pretty significant, and then they came back later in the process, and, oh, you probably need us to be on a consultative basis, da da da. And the buyer was like, well, we don't need you. You told us we don't need you, so we're gonna go along without you. So you have to be fairly consistent on the approach with that. And if you're not, I think it can bite you a little bit. And again, it's about being as clear about what the business is without that sort of thing as you possibly can.
On a high level, what are the top three reasons lemonades fail after the transaction is completed? In your recent experience, last 3 to 5 years.
Well, there was a famous study written about that in the Harvard Business Review like 1,000 years ago. And then the most acquisitions fail. I think it's they're done for the wrong reasons. When I first got out of school, I worked for Dow Jones Industrial 30, and we bought companies because we had money stuck in Venezuela and we couldn't get it out. So we'd look at anything, you know, and people would become enamored with a person or an opportunity or whatever. And, you know, there was a time when companies paid for revenue synergies, you know, that if I bought Power Objects, I can sell Power Objects our ERP, clients our ERP systems, and they make some assumption about that, and that doesn't work out. So they paid based on that. And I think, so it's a whole myriad of things, but it's obviously misunderstanding what the opportunity might be. And I presume that people deal with that by paying too. If you don't pay too much, you have a better opportunity to make it work, I suppose.
From a seller side, though, there's enormous emotions going on, and somebody might dig their heels in against something. And like I say, where they talked us off the ledge, deals fall through because people get emotional and passionate about what they're doing, and it's like, well, screw you, I'll go do it on my own. You know what I mean? So I would not, seeing how the emotions flow through this whole thing, a seller needs to step back and take guidance from the people that are advising them and slow down sometimes and not get too emotional. So very.
You know, just that I'm thinking about this a little bit more. We looked at a deal that we sold to a private equity firm that we thought had enormous potential and didn't play out at all. And they were kind enough to share this with us and what happened. And what I realized in talking with them was the investment thesis that they predicated this on was entirely different than what we presented. And for one reason or another, I mean, they decided that was a better thesis, but it didn't work.
So I would say it's people. So selling companies for me is bittersweet. I lose a client, but I oftentimes get those clients back. And part of it is because the personnel side of things didn't work out and they want to start something new. I just had a client that was sold about 6 months ago and was predicated on the entrepreneur becoming the CEO of the broader enterprise, and that happened, and it's not panning out the way this entrepreneur wanted it to, and there's different competing visions and so on, and he's already sort of thinking about the next thing. So from my perspective, it's all about people.
I would just add to that, people and their experience. We were with a client this morning that made a large acquisition over in Wisconsin, very experienced in their past and executed it beautifully. They're about to do another one in the Dakotas. I have full confidence it'll go extremely well because they're experienced. So it's people, their experience in doing it, and then executing, which are two things that are closely related. So,
and Tom, how about you? How have you seen deals not work out?
Well, I would say I'd echo the sentiments, what we've heard. I think culture matters. It seems like if the culture totally changes and the people leave, it's hard to execute.
Yeah. Was your question on what causes the deal to fall through before it happens, or what causes it to fail once the acquisition? Oh, okay.
That's what I was looking
for. Okay.
But you answered both.
Let the cat out of the bag. Yes.
You know, in the years I've been doing this, I've seen the cat let out of the bag very few times.
Okay.
I, you know, people, there isn't a, there isn't a proposal I've made where somebody hasn't said, well, we're a really small industry, and as soon as we hire you, everybody will know. And I can't think of when that's occurred. It really depends on how you know, that's part of our job, is to make sure that doesn't happen.
I was just gonna say, it's managing the process as best you can. I mean, as you get, as you progress, employees start learning about it, et cetera. I mean, it's sort of, it becomes more and more difficult to manage it a little bit, but it's all about managing it, managing the process.
Question over here.
Dean, when did you call the employees?
Oh, we still haven't told. No, I'm just kidding. No, so the Jim and I were the main owners of the company. So Jim and I were the ones to make all the decisions. We had all the controlling power. And we did not start bringing people in until very far into the process. And the first person, obviously, you bring in is the CFO. You got to generate numbers as you get into it more and more. But I would guess we were 6, 7, 8 months into it before the CFO was even brought into it. And employees did not know until the morning it happened. I would say, we're a professional service firm. I mean, they just did not know until the documents were all signed and done deal. I would guess out of the entire company, maybe 6 people knew prior to the transaction being done. So. I can't hear.
What the question was, when's the right time to sell?
I'll be visiting that. I'll see about it. From my perspective, you sold at the right time because you're so passionate about the business. From a buy side perspective, I look at the thing that destroys value more than anything else is dispassionate leadership. But it's kind of counterintuitive to sell when you're on the top and feeling good. So how do you advise your clients to be looking at selling when they're still having fun?
In my point of view, we controlled the transaction. We did not entertain all these offers to be acquired. So literally, I'd get a call every month. You know, we want to buy you, We just didn't entertain it because it wasn't. So there wasn't a matter of them selling me on, hey, now's a good time to go sell. Now's a good time to sell. I knew it was time to sell, and then we went to the market with it. We got the people we trusted to help us sell the company, because I don't know how to sell a company. I know how to run a professional service firm. So we went to experts in the industry to guide us through that process. And I tend to believe that every process is a little different. I think ours was longer. I think our company was really ready to sell, meaning we focused on our books, we focused on our numbers, we focused on profit, we focused on growth. We focused on what we thought our buyers wanted. And so, no one convinced us, now's the time to sell, Dean. You got to go to market. It's like, no, we went to market when we were ready.
The key drivers, the management and ownership don't necessarily need to be tied, right? In Dean's case, they were, right? The key drivers of the business on the operational side were also the key owners of the business. That's not always the case, right? Oftentimes you have situations where the ownership is disconnected, at least to some degree, from the management and operations of the business, and the folks that might be actually driving the business that are passionate about it and really want to create more value, see the transaction as an opportunity potentially to maybe participate as an owner in the future, but also just as a new direction for the business where the owners were more conservative, wanted to harvest cash, et cetera.
You know, the best time to sell if you're after a high value is when the future prospects of the business are really good. Can I tell them? So when we, you know, when Dean and Jim, who is his COO, came to us, we evaluated it, and our conclusion amongst ourselves before we even said we'd like to work on this was they were selling a product that was the fastest growing enterprise software in the world. They were the leading channel partner for that product. They had developed a unique ability to recruit and retain people. Which is a principle, you know, after you have the channel partner relationship with Microsoft, being able to recruit and train and lead people is that's the key asset. And they had demonstrated that they could successfully execute large, small, and complex projects profitably at what they bid them or better. So that said to us that there was a clear this was a, there's a clear fundamental path to growth here, and this is an engine that somebody can ride. That's a good time to sell, you know, because all you have to do is get it in the hands of somebody who will, who wants to drive it and feed it. You know, whereas, you know, if you're having a terrible year and you've had enough, that's a really bad time to say. You want to, I mean, it is a question of what it's worth. Nobody will buy it. How do you buy a falling knife, is what they say.
I think it's facts and circumstances. My partner, Tony Creer, who's here, we spoke on the way down. He has a client who is not active in the business and is not passionate about the business and doesn't work in the business. And we're probably looking at $3, $4 million of income, but the market is valuing his company at $45 million. He has an offer for that. I think the time is right for him to sell. He's not emotionally invested. It's just an investment. But take another client who loves going to work, young, it's growing, passionate about it. Our advice is, let's see how much wealth we can get for you outside the business, and not everything is tied up inside. In that case, I don't think the time is right.
John, when people are sharing their financials with you and you're talking about what bankers talk about behind closed doors, what kind of counsel do you give folks about when is the time right to sell?
I think a lot of that has been answered very well up here already. It just has a lot to do with what the family's objectives are and what's going on in their end markets, and is it the right time for them as a family. So I don't really have a lot to add. There's been a lot of good insight given up here already.
Over there in the back. Yeah. From the buy side, on a transaction where you've got key personnel that link the value of the company, how do you work the deal to make sure that they stick around or are motivated afterward when they're likely to end up with full pockets after the transaction?
Well, I think Chip alluded to it earlier. I think there's kind of two pieces of it. Help keeping them motivated and incentivized through the transaction, and then sort of what happens on the back end of it. And to a large degree, what happens on the back end of it really depends on who the buyer is and what the buyer's vision for them operationally is post-closing. But from the up to the transaction point, there's lots of different things you can do from a compensation perspective to make sure that the right people are aligned, that they're committed. But there's a little bit of a balancing act too, right? You want to make sure that they're committed, but that they're going to stay with the enterprise, and that they're not, you know, they're getting the right balance of compensation for what they're doing.
But I mean, we've seen buyers have retention escrows and things.
I guess tied to that, what percentage is are tied to earnouts on the deals you see, and how often do owners stay around, and then is there a probability of success of that actually happening?
I've heard multiple stories from other people I know that are selling companies. Our deal does have an earnout associated with it. Okay, so the question is what is our number? What do we have to have? Well, the amount I took off the table day one was my number. The amount I sandbagged for what we could do year one is, sweet, I'll take that. Year two, yep, I'll have that too, thank you. And year three, I don't really care. So yes, I think there's more and more earnouts. I have heard horror stories. I was just in Seattle last week, and someone was telling me that the company, friend sold the company, and it was all tied to earnouts, and they just made it so there's no way you'd ever make your earnout. We happen to have a great buyer. They're leaving us in charge, or letting us make decisions, or letting us do a lot of stuff. Now, is it different? Sure. 110,000 employee organizations different than a 300. We no longer can just pause the music and make a decision. So, but every seller is going to have to make that decision. Is that the right price? And you know, in our case, it sure was.
So you suggest having your dollar, your number, taken off the table right away, and then.
I'm not going to say I suggest that. That's was my requirement. I wanted my number locked in. And if they wanted to offer me more, that offer more, I mean, think about it. If I bought a company, I might say, as long as you keep it going as what I bought, I'm happy. Someone else might say, as long as you don't let it drop 10%, I'm happy. Someone else might say, you need to continue to grow at 40% plus. You know. So you're selling something. they were giving us what the company was worth, I believe, and I think they were incenting us to grow up even more. So, great.
You know. I do think that question, though, of I always tell clients, if you don't get any of the earnout, are you going to be content with the transaction? And if you can't answer that in the affirmative, you really got to think hard about it, because there is, from a legal perspective, there's lots of potential risk on an earnout, as Dean was alluding to, depending on who the buyer is, how they run the business, could dramatically impact whether or not you're going to get those dollars.
You know, and I think that question of whether you should do it or not, could be answered this way. If you run a broad enough process, you're going to get a lot of alternative offers, and you're going to see what's a good offer. What's an all-cash offer worth? What's an offer for 80% of the business center rollover 20% worth? What's an offer for X with an earnout? And so you get to make a choice. And I've had, we've had many clients who said, I would never do a deal with a private equity firm, who've done it and done it really well, because they like the guys, they like, they looked at their 20% rollover is a better investment than putting it in the stock market. I've had guys who have taken earnouts and done fabulously well. And I really have only had one deal that we worked on a number of years ago where the earnout didn't work out, and that was, you know, frankly, our client's fault.
I'll throw a little compliment here to Franklin. We're presently working on a deal together, a little bit of the hockey stick scenario, but Joe has done a phenomenal job selling it. We're in the second round of the LOIs, and about 80% of the price is cash, and about 20% of the cash is earnout. I think it's a stretch number that we hit that EBITDA, and they did a really good job, Franklin. They went back and renegotiated the earnout based on revenue. It's a lot easier to hit a revenue bogey than it is an EBITDA number.
Side, John?
We see it a lot. We see it a lot as part of financing transactions, both private equity and otherwise. It helps. It's a strip of junior capital that helps bring together an overall financing transaction. So it's a good form of incentive to keep management engaged and ownership that's rolling that equity or debt engaged. And so we see a lot for, I think, all the right reasons typically.
My two cents worth on that at Venture Fund that I was a part of, our best deal was a deal where, kind of like Dean mentioned, we took what we wanted off the table, had a 3-year earnout, but that was a software company, and getting acceptance on the software took a little bit of a period of time, so we did it on orders, not on acceptance because of that lead time. I thought they could play games, and we ended up hitting virtually all 3 years of the numbers and ended up almost doubling what the price tag was for the business. So be careful. I agree with everybody what they're saying, and earnout's a great way to make the deal look like what you want, so be careful with terms and make sure you protect yourself. Kind of getting to the finish line, one last question from the audience. I got a couple things I'd wrap up here. Neil, we already gave you one, so. Unless you want to pay extra. No, I'm kidding. We got a handful of minutes here. One question that I haven't gotten to, but what would be a mistake that you would make sure that a seller would not want to make? And likewise, what might be a mistake that a buyer might make? Just kind of a quick answer off the cuff to that question.
So seller, and I think Chip alluded to it earlier, I mean, you have to run a transparent process whatever you're doing. So if there's some skeleton in the closet, I think you have to bring it out there, and you have to position it, and you have to identify it, because through the legal process, the last thing you want is to be looked at as disingenuous and trying to hide something, if you will. I think on the buy side, actually running through this on a deal right now, be very, very careful about repositioning the price based on diligence discoveries. You can if you really want to do the deal, because you can very well kill a deal that way. You can put a seller, seller's leverage position is to walk on those type of things, and I think it better be important enough for them to kill the deal, because it very well could.
I think the Twin Cities just has an absolute plethora of really, really good investment bankers.
but not everybody is a really good investment banker. And what we see a lot is overpromising and under-delivering. If somebody comes in with a multiple that's too good to be true, it usually is. And I think you gotta be a little bit leery of the reputation of who you're doing business with.
I would say from a sell side, the biggest mistake you can make would be not attempting to do it on your own, I should say. So engage people that are experts in the field. So if you think you're going to get a phone call from someone that wants to buy your company, you're going to sell it over a phone call, you're crazy. And your best bet is to take it to the experts, let them sell the company, you keep running your business.
And on the sell side, just repeating something I said before, just have your financial house in order. Be squeaky clean. Make sure your numbers are scrubbed and absolutely clean and ready to go. On the buy side, peel that onion, dig deep, find out what's out there, and make sure you know what you're getting yourself into.
I would agree with everything everyone said. I'd add one thing, and that's if you're going to do this, you really need to be committed to it, because it's a long, rigorous process, and it's no fun to go through it and not get to the end. And it's also damaging to the value of your business to not be successful at this. So you should figure out if you want to do it, be committed to do it, hire a good team to do it, run a process, and have an advocate to push the deal to the close. Otherwise, you're just wasting a lot of time and money, a lot of money. And we haven't talked about that. There's a lot, people like us are paid on the end, but everybody else is paid by the hour, and you're talking about hundreds of thousands of dollars.
I would just add one point to the buy side is have a good attorney, you mentioned before, so have an attorney who knows how to work in an M&A transaction. You end up running into a lot of companies where they might be a great attorney for everyday business, but they've not really been involved in the M&A process, and it really makes things difficult and costs everybody a lot more money.
For someone who wants to educate themselves about either the process or just what the kind of jargon and lingo and how it works, any suggestions for books, reference materials, websites? Short of calling you, is there anything they can do just to get up the curve themselves? A lot of folks who are used to doing things themselves, is there a way they can just kind of get a certain base level of knowledge on the topic?
Is there a Donald Trump joke in here?
Yeah. Okay, you think about that. While you're doing that, last thing would be closing thoughts. Anything you want to leave the audience with? No particular order.
I would just probably reiterate what Chip said. If you're interested, you need the right experts to run a process. You can't go it alone. I know from time to time clients have asked myself, will you sell your business for me? Absolutely not. It's a lot of hard work, and bringing the experts who know what they're doing.
It's your life's work, so take it seriously, take the process seriously, and do everything you can to have a good outcome.
Kind of going back to have a good advisor, they can help you know what's going on in the marketplace. The M&A market, the capital markets, the syndication market have all changed dramatically from just the end of the calendar year. So what happened in 2015 is very old news. Multiples have changed. We just had our capital markets people up from Chicago yesterday talking to a company that thought it was going to sell itself for $250 million. They're $100 million below that. And even now, what they want to do, the markets are completely different. So be talking to the right people who can keep you up abreast of what's going on out there.
I would say do what you do best. So we hired Franklin Partners, Great Plant Moody. They know how to sell a company. Jim and I know how to run a professional service firm. We brought in experts to help us sell it. We continue to run our company. So do what you do best.
I guess I would add to that, pick people you trust. People you can connect with. So you're going to spend a lot of time with them. You're going to trust their judgment. Everything they do is going to reflect on you. So pick people who you think their value and the way they present themselves is consistent with the way
you want to be a percentage.